Madam Foreign Secretary, thank you very much for your time. It's no secret, of course, that India and China must work together to safeguard the world's environment. These two countries are amongst the globe's biggest polluters, but they're also now today amongst the leading emerging nations. They also could potentially impact each other's water shortages, but they're also amongst the quickest growing economies today. My question is this: will they work together, and what's the incentive?
Well, James, it's a pleasure to be talking to you today. Yes, India and China definitely are the biggest developing countries. And I can scarcely fail to emphasize the importance of collective and coordinated action among all developing countries to tackle the problem of climate change. I think India and China have established a very good example of cooperation to deal with climate change and to link it, and this is important, to link it to sustainable development.
If we look at the hard numbers and we look at the hard facts, China and India have a combined GDP of almost $6 trillion. How can you leverage that kind of position?
On the Millennium Development Goals, I think both our countries have been able to register significant milestones, especially where the goal of poverty reduction is concerned. In fact, India itself is expected to lift 188 million people out of poverty by 2015.
Do you really think you can make that a reality?
This is definitely going to be a reality.
Now, of course, AIDS is one of the crucial MDGs. What does AIDS matter to you personally?
I think we need collective global action, working together to look at the best care that we can deliver to people who are afflicted by this disease, and also to improve the quality of the medications and the preventive care that we must also stress.
The India-China relationship has been so often discussed and very, very much debated, as you said, not always straightforward. What do you think is likely to happen next?
The world is talking today about the reform of the UN Security Council and finding a place for nations who deserve to be permanent members of the Security Council. And India counts itself among that group of countries. We believe that India is a deserving candidate for permanent membership of the Security Council. We would like to see greater understanding from China of India's case for permanent membership of the Security Council. There is, of course, a groundswell developing within the membership of the United Nations. More than 140 countries have recently supported the launch of text-based negotiations within the United Nations for expansion of the Security Council, both in the permanent and non-permanent categories.
Of course, one of the other big MDGs is gender equality. Being in a top job in a huge democracy, what kind of a message do you think it sends out? Do you hear stories of young girls come up to you and saying, "Mrs. Rao, you inspire me"?
There's a lot of exposure when you have a woman in a leadership position. And India has set a number of good examples in that field, as you know, starting with our first woman prime minister, Mrs. Indira Gandhi, and who is a world figure, and I think was remembered across the world for her leadership and for her inspirational qualities even today. I think women are increasingly emerging to find their voice and their rightful position.
Madam Foreign Secretary, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you very much, James. A pleasure to be here. Thank you.